Hi, I am Maker Giovanni and welcome back to my channel. In today's video, I'll show you how I built an essential tool if you are into electronics that no one has ever thought of before. We are talking about a lab bench power supply, but not just the usual one, a portable super compact lab bench power supply powered by a USB-C port with a magnetic lamp on top to illuminate the work area and many other features. I think we've all had to do electronic repairs on the go, carrying a soldering iron, multimeter, various tools, and the giant lab bench power supply. There are many compact soldering irons out there, but no one seems to have ever thought of a lab bench power supply. So I set to work to build a lightweight and compact power supply, integrating many features that I had never seen in any other project. First of all, the power. I switched from a mains voltage plug to a USB-C port, which allows us to run everything with our phone charger or even a power bank. But I didn't stop there, and I created a magnetic system that allows us to place additional modules on top of the power supply, such as a lamp to keep the work area illuminated at all times. On the front, we also have a space to store the cables, to always keep them neat and tidy. In addition to all this, we have the function of a regular lab bench power supply, like digital voltage and current adjustment and a screen to see the set values and current draw. It's the perfect project for doing repairs on the go, if we don't have much space in the workshop or even to pack in our suitcase when we go on vacation. But now, let's get started! The key component of this project is a voltage regulator. The one I chose has digital voltage and current control and a display showing the voltage and current draw of the load. Plus, for a module that only costs 12 euros, it's also quite accurate. On the back, we have two terminals for the input voltage and two for the output. Inside there is a step up and step down regulator, which allows us to set the output voltage from 0 all the way to 36 volts. First, I connected a 12 volts power supply to the input terminals. The module turns on with no problems, so we can test it with a 1 watt LED, which I connected to the positive and negative terminals of the output. After setting the LED voltage, I also set the maximum current to supply to avoid destroying the LED. Turn on the output and we can see that the LED lights up, and by adjusting the current, the light intensity also changes. At this point, all we need to do is to 3D print a container for the module, and we'd have a fully functional lab bench power supply. Looking at the circuit, however, something is terribly wrong. The 12 volts power supply that powers everything is heavy and bulky, definitely way too much for a tool that needs to be portable. This power supply can produce 60 watts, and thinking about it, I have a much more compact power supply, the one from my MacBook, which is 70 watts. My smartphone charger is even more compact and still produces 25 watts. What these power supplies and even this power bank have in common is the USB-C power delivery technology, which allows us to get different voltages from 5 up to a maximum of 20 volts from a USB-C port. However, if we cut a USB cable and connect it to one of these power supplies, we only get 5 volts. So, how do we get 20 volts? The answer is a trigger board like this. Once connected to the power supply, by pressing the button we can select different voltages, and even if we cut the power, the setting remains saved. At this point, all I had to do was connecting the trigger board to the voltage regulator input. 3, 2, 1 and everything works great, both with the MacBook power supply and with the power bank. And so the basic circuit of our lab bench power supply is ready. Now we have to turn this mess of wires into something that looks more like a finished product. First, I started designing a container to 3D print to assemble all the parts. As always in my projects, I try to pay as much attention as possible to the overall design, so designing the container took quite a bit of time. When I was happy with the result, I sent it to the 3D printer, and after a few hours, here is the finished print. After removing this support, we have the actual container and its lid, which gets mounted on the back. 3D printing is a really useful technology for makers, but not everyone has access to a printer to make their own parts. That's where my sponsor JLCPCB comes into play. JLCPCB is a company that manufactures high-quality 1-to-8 layer printed circuit boards, starting at just $2. The ordering process is very simple, just upload your Gerber files and select the different parameters to get an instant quote and proceed with the purchase. JLCPCB also offers a 3D printing service with different technologies and materials, from the regular FDM printing to SLA resin printing and even metal printing. Again, ordering is very simple, and after a few days the parts are delivered at your door, with excellent quality and surface finish and ready to be assembled. All this at a very low price, and what's more, by clicking on the link in the description you can find many coupons for both PCBs and 3D printing. Once the parts were printed, I first mounted the voltage regulator, which fits into the opening on the case. Then I mounted the trigger board with the USB-C port, and by pressing the button I set it to 20 volts. Obviously not all USB-C power supplies are capable of providing 20 volts, but in that case the board will automatically select the highest available voltage, which can be 9 or 12 volts. I used the cables to connect the positive and negative terminals of the trigger board to the input terminals of the voltage regulator. To connect the load to the power supply, I chose to use cables with alligator clips, which will be stored inside the power supply in the space on the front. So I got some alligator clips and silicone cables, which I soldered to the clips. However, I wanted to be able to replace the clips with other connectors, such as a barrel jack to power an electronic device. So I soldered an XT60 connector to the cables, which allows me to disconnect the alligator clips to connect other accessories. The space on the front of the power supply has a hole at the top for the wires, which I then connected to the two output terminals. Once I had finished the connections, I ran a test, and I would say our power supply works great. To complete the project, all that remained to do was to close the rear panel, but while designing all the parts I had an idea. What if I put a lamp on top of the power supply? Okay, not this lamp, but maybe a light that could be useful when repairing an electronic device. And what if this lamp was in some way a separate module that we could add to the power supply only when needed? So after years of research and development, the lamp module was born. Yours at $6.99. To make the lamp, we first need some LEDs. The first ones that came to my mind were the classic 5mm LEDs, but the problem is that they don't make much light. So I chose these 1W LEDs, which cost just a few cents but are very bright. I designed the structure of the lamp around these LEDs, and when I was happy with it, I 3D printed it in red PLA. As before, we have two parts, the structure of the lamp and a panel to close it. In addition to these parts, I printed a black wall that goes inside the lamp, to avoid this effect when we turn it on. In the lamp we are going to mount 3 LEDs, and to secure them I choose to use an aluminum profile, which will also help dissipate heat. After cutting it two sides, I adapted it to fit into the 3D printed part. The LEDs will be positioned on this profile, using two screws for each one. Before securing them, I put a thermal paste under each LED, which will help conduct the heat from the LEDs to the aluminum. Now that the LEDs are secured, we need to think about the circuit to make them work. Each LED has a voltage of 3.4 volts, so with the 20 volts provided by the USB-C we can connect them in series. This way we have two cables for positive and negative from the LEDs, but if we connected them directly to the 20 volts of the USB-C we would fry them. As with all LEDs we need to limit the current they receive. Normally we would use a resistor, but in this case we'd lose almost half the energy as heat. So after a bit of research I found this circuit, an LED driver with current limiting that uses a step-down converter, and so is much more efficient. I connected the driver to the LEDs, and by turning the potentiometer to adjust the current, I fried them. This happened because I accidentally raised the current above 300 milliamps, which is the max current for these LEDs. Using all my patience I replaced them, but to do more testing I prefer to use a load resistor and connect the LEDs only later. Not having a suitable one I used an electric iron, which is basically a resistor with a plug connected to it. Here I noticed a problem, it is practically impossible to precisely adjust the current going to the LEDs using the potentiometer. So I decided to desolder it, and replace it with two 10K and 3.3K resistors in series, which give an output current of about 180 milliamps. This way the LEDs will never operate at maximum current, avoiding to overheat. Finally I soldered two cables to the driver input, placing a switch on the positive wire. And so the lamp circuit is almost complete, and the light produced by the LEDs is really bright. The last thing we need is a way to power the lamp. Here I found the inspiration on my desk, the Apple MagSafe connector. Using simple magnets it keeps the connector in place, while creating an electrical connection. Adopting a system like this to mount the lamp would have really taken the project to the next level, so I started thinking about how to make a similar connector. On AliExpress I found these magnetic connectors, which are very well made and designed so that it is impossible to reverse polarity. To mount the lamp I will use two pairs oriented in opposite directions, so that the lamp can be mounted either forwards or backwards, because, well, why not? First I prepared two pairs of connectors of the same type with positive and negative connected together. I connected one pair to the lamp circuit, while the other will be placed in the lab bench power supply. Here I connected the positive and negative directly to the trigger board with the USB-C port. On the top of the power supply I designed two spaces for the magnetic connectors, which I secured with hot glue. The connectors will be installed in the same way in the lamp module, but first we need to assemble the other components. Actually, on the front something is still missing, a diffuser for the lights from the LEDs. To make it I started with a piece of acrylic, which I cut to size. I then sanded both sides with fine sandpaper to make it matte. Then I put it into place, but first I covered the edge with black tape, again to avoid this effect. I secured the acrylic by inserting the inner part of the lamp, and then I glued the heatsink with the LEDs. I also secured the two magnetic connectors, and the switch in the hole on top. Now that the lamp was ready I could close the rear panel, and to do so I used two threaded inserts and M3 screws. Using M3 screws I also closed the rear panel of the power supply. And this is the best moment. Our power supply is completed, and the lamp works perfectly. As a bonus, the lamp also has a space to place screws when we disassemble something, for those who, like me, lose them every single time. The power supply itself also works well, and the voltage regulation is very accurate, while there is a deviation of a few milliamps in the current, which I think is acceptable for such a cheap circuit. The opening at the front allows us to store the cables and secure them with a Velcro strap, making it very convenient to transport. The magnetic connectors allow us to create other modules in addition to the lamp, such as a fume extractor for soldering, or even an entire soldering station. Anyway, this power supply will always be with me during all repairs on the go, and if you want to build it yourself, you can find all the files to 3D print below in the description. As always, if you are interested in electronics, check out my channel, and maybe subscribe. Bye, and we will see you at the next video.